All right, Dr. Ron, when you see this video, I mean, this is what you do. You're a forensic criminologist. Was this use of deadly force justified?
Well, I'm not going to make that determination. We'll let the trier of fact, but let's talk about the facts of this case. I think you've done a wonderful job articulating what we can see. I've literally written the book on the psychological and physiological effects of taser electronic energy into the body based on what I've trained officers and what I've, of course, tased hundreds and hundreds of people in experiments. And it can be have devastating effects with regards to what we call NMI or neuromuscular incapacitation. So devastating effects are not necessarily injurious effects, but what it does is lock up. If the officer shot properly with the taser, just like any suspect, it's designed to completely lock up the officer muscularly, bones. He'll fall to the ground, sustain a secondary impact injury, more likely than not, given the velocity of the speed that he was running at, and he can easily be disarmed, and that weapon can be taken from him and used against him. So the prosecution here has got a number of problems that they're going to have to deal with. First of all, the de-escalation issue. I've watched all the videos that are available so far. And the officers did a very good job on de-escalating. They were constantly acting respectful and professionally. They tried to make an arrest, which was a peaceful arrest. All it required to Mr. Brooks to do is simply comply to custody for a misdemeanor offense of drunk driving or being drunk in and out of his vehicle. The taking of a taser from an officer, depending on the state, can be viewed as a felony. And then turning around in just a nanosecond and brandishing and attempting to shoot this officer in the dark, the officer doesn't necessarily know whether it's a taser that's hitting him or he's drawing a weapon. And so the trier of fact would have to go with the jury instructions as to what constitutes the officer's reasonable belief that the subject was presenting him with an imminent threat of serious bodily injury or death. So they've got some real problems. The shooting in the back, if you look at the video and look at the temporal relationship, in other words, the timing between the brandishing and turning around and turning back around, all of the studies which are vetted, published studies, I've done many of these studies, show that a person can turn around, point a deadly weapon at an officer, and then turn back around in 25 hundredths of a second. But the officer's, what we call action, reaction, perception, lag time is way behind the curve there. So the officer is always at a disadvantage because action, meaning the suspect's action, is always going to be faster than reaction.
And going back to what you said a moment ago, that the police officer may have thought that it was a firearm and not just a taser, what if the police officer knew that it was just a taser? Is the use of deadly force justified on the officer's part if he knew that it was just a taser being aimed at him?
It absolutely can, and taser instructors, and again, I've literally written the book on this, taser instructors across the nation train end user officers, in other words, taser instructors train end users officers, that this absolutely can become a deadly force threat. Certainly serious bodily injury, and that's all the law requires is a reasonable belief of serious bodily injury.